Surveying the dental cast is an important preliminary procedure used in the diagnosis and treatment planning of the removable partial denture. In this video, we will demonstrate and discuss the armamentarium, rationale, and procedure for surveying. There are several components involved in surveying. The surveying table, to which the cast is attached, has a locking knob which allows the table to swivel. The cast is secured to the table with a locking pin. The surveyor base, vertical arm, horizontal arm, a movable vertical spindle. The spindle moves up and down and may be secured with a set screw. A small collet is used to attach the surveying tools to the vertical spindle. When the surveying tools are not in use, they may be stored in the metal column. Surveying tools consist of an analyzing rod, cylindrical graphite marker and supporting rod, a carving tool, and a selection of undercut gauges. The analyzing rod is used to locate tooth surfaces that are or can be made parallel for use as guiding planes. The analyzing rod may also be used to detect areas of undercut. It is important to check the roundness of the analyzing rod prior to its use, as it is easily damaged. The graphite marker is used to delineate the survey line, which defines the height of contour at a given path. Replace the marker if it is worn. Rotating the marker in use will extend the service life of the marker. Use the metal sheath to prevent fracture of the delicate graphite in use. A carving tool is useful to simulate tooth preparations on the cast. Normally, if the restorative procedure can be successfully simulated on the cast, it can be performed in the mouth. Undercut gauges allow one to measure the depth of undercut relative to the height of contour. They are usually scaled in inches and are designated as 0.01 inches, 0.02 inches, and 0.03 inches. Analysis of the dental cast with the surveyor consists of examination for guiding planes, retention, interferences to the path of insertion, and to optimize the aesthetic result. To begin the surveying procedure, ensure that the base of the cast is flat. Secure the cast to the survey table. The occlusal plane of the cast should be level with the table. Cast may be tipped anteriorly. The cast may be tipped posteriorly. These movements are used to align the guiding planes. The cast may be moved laterally. This movement is useful to redistribute or relocate the undercut. The analyzing rod is secured to the vertical spindle. The vertical spindle is unlocked so that it will move up and down. The parallelism of the abutments for guiding planes is analyzed. The question one asks is, what must I do to make these abutments parallel? This may require minor anomaloplasty, or it may require a complete cast restoration. Next, retentive areas are examined. Retention is ideally located in the gingival one-third of the tooth. In this case, the analyzing rod is showing a triangle of light, indicating an area of retention. The analyzing rod is also used to examine interferences to the path of placement. This particular buccal exostosis may interfere with the placement of the eye bar or a well-adapted base. The undercut is then measured with an undercut gauge. The shank is placed in contact with the tooth and raised until the nib touches the tooth. At this point, 0.02-inch undercut exists relative to the height of contour. Embrasure spaces may be evaluated for symmetry. Symmetrical embrasure spaces will be more aesthetic. Embrasure spaces are also evaluated for the effect of guide plane preparation. Occasionally, guide plane preparation may be minimized or may be made more aesthetic by judicious tipping of the cast. Fixed restorations are normally recommended for anterior modification spaces. Also, evaluate for the presence of dark triangles. Sometimes these can be adjusted by anterior-posterior tipping of the cast. It should be noted, however, that this gives precedence of this particular item over the path of insertion, so one should carefully evaluate whether or not a fixed restoration would be more useful. Each abutment in turn is examined. Then the carbon marker is placed in the vertical spindle. The carbon marker is used to delineate the height of contour. This line is known as the survey line. The survey line is used to mark the entire circumference of the tooth. Ideally, the survey line is found in about the middle one-third of the tooth. Now the marker is being used to mark the height of contour of a buccal exostosis. Each abutment is marked in turn. The path of insertion is now defined by tripodding the cast. In this method, the vertical spindle is used to make three widely spaced marks on the outside edge of the cast. The vertical spindle is not locked at this point. The cast may then be removed and replaced to reorient the cast. Another method of tripodding requires the placement of three widely spaced dots on the cast. Using the carbon marker, three widely spaced dots are placed. In this procedure, the vertical spindle is locked. The marks are circled with red pencil to distinguish them from stray carbon markings. Here, the carving tool is being used to contour the wax pattern for a surveyed crown. The carving tool may be used to place guiding planes as well as lingual contouring. Other simulations may be performed on the stone cast. If it can be done on the cast, then it can be done in the mouth. This video has described the procedure for surveying, including the surveying armamentarium, a surveying rationale, which includes the location of guiding planes, the identification of undercuts, the identification of possible interferences to the path of insertion, and to evaluate the aesthetics of the restoration. Tripodding was demonstrated, as well as simulation of a restoration. Thank you.